Hello and welcome back to Proactive. I'm joined on the line now by the CEO David Palumbo and COO Jeffrey Vander Linden from EQTEC. And we're going to start with you, David, this morning. You've had some news from your Deeside project last week.
Yeah, hi Thomas, how are you doing? Good morning. Yes, we announced that we could not reach a commercial agreement with the investor that we're discussing on the terms for the investment. And this is natural as well. This is part of the process. We are in discussion with a number of potential investors, as is customary when you run an investment in a project of any scale. Typically, most of these negotiations happen in behind closed door in confidence. But in this specific case, we have to make a regulatory announcement because of the negotiation, because there were certain binding elements in the terms, like the extension of the loan stop date and the investor covering development costs during negotiation. So that required announcing to the market. We started a discussion with this investor back in May to acquire the project SPV and to finance the final stages of the development. Since then, circumstances have changed significantly, both for the project and the investor. So from the project side, the project is further de-risked and developed, and we're continuing discussion with all the other parties and some of them with strategic value beyond this project. It's critical for the success of this type of projects that we find the best investor configuration for the project, you know, one that will support the project for the long term. You know, this is a reference project that we will use as an example of what can be done in industrial decarbonization for the many years to come. So the ideal configuration for this project will be a consortium of strategic partners with aligned interests beyond just the financial metrics of the project. So with this type of investor consortium, we'll ensure that we'll have a rapid execution and successful operation once the financial close of the project is achieved. So we will continue the discussions and we think we are tracking in good shape both the development and this discussion with other investors.
That's understood, David. Thank you. And Jeff, this does mean that you've had to update your revenue guidance for the full year, doesn't it?
Yes, yes, it does. And, you know, that's very disappointing, of course, you know, particularly when, as David and I have said many times before, we genuinely believe that the intrinsic value of the company is growing, you know, with each passing quarter of the year. So it is disappointing to have to adjust the guidance. I mean, we flagged this in September in our interim results. When we have a portfolio of the size that we have it, and, you know, when we have a single project that is so much bigger than some of the other ones, inevitably we're going to be sensitively dependent on it. But as David's indicated, you know, in his previous response, you know, we remain committed to this project. It's a very important project for us as a reference, as he said. But let's also remember that Toyota is one of our offtake partners for this. And we see this as very important for Toyota as well as part of their overall green agenda. So we remain very committed to pushing this along. And let's remember, you know, we haven't announced that for some reason the project has disappeared or the project has gone, you know, pear-shaped. You know, as David said, you know, the revenue is not going away. It's simply moving into the next period. And although that hurts our annual results this year, we're going to see that in our results for next year. And so, you know, at the risk of just reiterating some of what David said, you know, these large capital projects always take longer than expected in reaching financial close. There are inevitably a number of potential investors who show interest in this, and Deeside is no exception. And as we've said repeatedly, our strategy is to move to talking to more and more large corporates, whether they be industrial players such as Toyota, or whether they be other utility players or large-scale infrastructure investors. And we see a range of those that we're moving, you know, to discussions with. So, you know, we have to manage this when we forecast, and we have to, you know, take the hit that it's not going to hit within period, but we absolutely remain committed to it. And this should in no way overshadow our continued execution of business strategy. You know, we are moving on with the Italy MDC. We have three other MDCs in the frame. We have the Deeside project, and we have a number of very exciting projects that we can come on and talk about.
Thanks, Jeff. Now, you've mentioned the Market Development Center in Italy there. Is it really still on track to be up and running by the end of this year?
Yes. You know, even despite, I should say, the headwinds that we've seen with commodity pricing and other supply chain disruptions. I mean, to be honest, the plant's been ready to go several times over the past few months. But in the end, we, like many others, have been waiting for the arrival of key components, or we've had to pull on third-party specialists to come in and do specific maintenance on some of the ancillary non-EQTEC technologies. And inevitably, that drags out the timeline. So it's been a little bit frustrating, if I'm very honest. But I have to say, all credit goes to Yoel Aleman, our CTO, the engineering team that we have in Barcelona, and the O&M team, I should say, as well, who have been setting up and preparing with us. Also, our great partners, COSME, who have been doing the EPC work on site, you know, have all been crucial to taking this as far and as fast as it's gone. We are on the cusp of mechanical and electrical completion. I think we more or less have achieved that. We are missing one single, relatively small but critical component from a major manufacturer, it should be said. But again, even the major manufacturers are bringing us some delays with delivery of those final pieces. However, we are assured that it will arrive in a timely way, and we're still very confident that we'll be able to complete and commission and go live with that plant in December this month. I should add, one of the exciting things that we see about the Italy plant, and as we announced in our recent RNS, you know, we took a decision to upgrade the plant effectively. And, you know, luckily we've got a great set of investors on that plant who shared our desire to do that. There were three things we did, and these all add to the kind of the resilience, both operationally and commercially, of the plant. First of all, we added a second feeding in line so that we can take both high density and low density feedstocks. And as the market shifts and changes, as price point changes in the market for feedstock, we can change the mix, or we can move entirely to a different feedstock to accommodate those shifting changes and keep prices relatively or costs relatively low versus the offtake. The other thing we've done is we've put a dryer and thermal oxidizer on site that allows us to take humid or dry feedstock and dry it right there on the site. And that gives us a wider range of, again, feedstock that we can purchase and then put through the system accordingly. And the third thing that's crucial, we've seen this in what we're doing in California and also in Croatia, is that we've added a biochar production capability. So that gives us yet another revenue stream for the offtake and substantially enhances the commercial potential of the plant. So that takes us beyond the grid connection and the preferential tariff we already have for the electrical power, and it gives us a whole biochar capability, which in the middle of an agricultural region makes a lot of sense. So all these augmentations and work have gone quite smoothly. Ironically, it's the small stuff and typically the ancillary stuff that's caused us some of the greatest challenges. But we'll push on and we'll go live this month.
Thank you, Jeff. Now, David, once we've gone live with the plant there in Italy, what happens next?
Sure, that's an important question. The short answer is the plant will receive and process agricultural and forestry waste, will generate power to be exported to the national grid in a very carbon efficient way. We also have finalized it now, the agreements for the offtake or the purchase of biochar. Once we start selling the biochar as well, and we're able to capture the carbon credits from the biochar, the plant will become carbon negatively as using the biochar as a way to effectively sequester CO2. The plant will generate revenues and profits, and it's a healthy business. But as you know, for EQTEC, we will continue to have very strong interest in the plant. We are contracted by the company that owns the plant as the operator and the technology provider. We have a minimum of a 2-year maintenance contract with the project SPV, and probably we'll look to extend it for the lifetime of the plant. We'll be, you know, very lucky in finding strong local operators, good track records that will be running the plant. And we've been working with them over the last couple of months to get them onboarded and trained for the operation and maintenance of the EQTEC facilities.
So, David, we've heard a lot about the MDC in Italy in this interview so far, but could you elaborate a little bit more on what is EQTEC's direct relationship with it and where it fits into the company's overall strategy?
Sure. I mean, from a commercial and contractual point of view, we effectively have three relationships with the plant. So first, we are the co-investor in the company that owns the plant, and we have just under 20% equity or shares in the business. Second, we are also the technology provider that we not only provide the core equipment, but we did the full design, engineering, and integration for the entire plant. And we constructed with our support, with the support of our EPC partner, Cosmi, doing all the assembly and integration work on site. And third, we are the operator of the facility, as I mentioned before. So therefore, we ensure that the plant runs at maximum efficiency and performance from a technical point of view as well. Also, the important how this fits in the strategy, we have said many times, we cannot underplay the importance of these market development centers, MDCs. We will use this as a showcase for prospective customers of our technology, for training our own people, but also to train our partners' people to make the plan available for funders as well and operators, technical due diligence. This is critical because at the moment, you either need to take very long for doing a technical due diligence, or you need to take them to Movialza plan, which is not a plan that we own. And this slows things down, and you are able to do probably one or two of these due diligence a year, where now with the plant being under our operations, we can do many of this one as much as is required. So this will help accelerating and onboarding, particularly, more critically, project funders, which is what we need now at this stage of growth. The MDCs are important for us also because they can expect, the prospective customers or partner can experience the EQTEC technology operating in a live commercial environment. So this demonstrates not only the technology, but also the business model. This is very important. So what are the applications? What are the commercial model that these plants work? So for instance, in Italy MDC is a biomass to power and biochar plant for agricultural communities, the off-taker of this. In Croatia, MDC is industrial waste to power and biochar, but for an industrial off-taker. And in France, MDC, which we announced recently, will handle mixed waste for power just to sell to the grid. In the case of UK MDC, which we're calling Southport now, intends to be the first UK RDF plant to hydrogen at commercial scale. And we frankly believe that probably this is the first in Europe as well. And given the size of the project being smaller, we believe that we can have this online before any other plant producing hydrogen from waste.
Thank you, David. And it's just one final question from me. What is it that you think people can expect from EQTEC heading into 2023?
Sure. Well, we'll put in a lot of effort now as well to finalize commissioning the Croatian MDC and attracting new additional investment to it. You will see progress with the Deeside project, conversation with these investors, and this consortium of owners, operators will yield, will bear fruits, no doubt. So you see a push towards financial close and construction. What's happening in France, Jeff, that we could say?
Well, France MDC. I mean, I think, David, exactly as you say, the MDCs remain top priority because we have an MDC that demonstrates a set of business models that we think are critical for us for the future. So France MDC, we will sell the SPV and get some co-investors or investors in there, and we'll push to construction as quickly as we can. I doubt very much that we will commission and go live with that plant next year, but we can expect hopefully early 2024 for that one. I'll add while I'm at it, Livadia project in Greece is doing very well in terms of funding. That's moving ahead exactly as we anticipated this month in terms of getting the European Commission funding through a Greek bank, and then also moving on and getting some additional equity funding there. So that's making good progress, and we can expect that. I think in speaking with Joël Aleman, there's a potential that we could start commissioning at the back end of next year if construction goes very quickly, but it's more likely that will also go into 2024. The BMEC facility in California is also making very good progress. There's a critical application going in this month for funding that we expect to come good in Q1 of next year. So BMEC should make very good progress. And while I'm at it, the US now is becoming, particularly with the Inflation Reduction Act over there, becoming very, very active. And we are pursuing a number of potential routes there. We're not trying to go big immediately in the USA, of course. We're finding single projects that will help prove a very clear business model that we can support. And finally, the other thing I'd throw in, David, is Ireland now. We're beginning to see some very new interest emerging in Ireland that could move very quickly indeed for some large scale kind of industrial use, but a very interesting high tech, not surprisingly in Ireland, but high tech industrial.
Yeah, definitely. Ireland is very exciting because it's coming to a sector that is very, very well capitalized and growing very fast. So, and this is something that we can replicate. It's a new business model for us, and it will be very interesting. The other thing I think to add there in terms of we'll see larger investors in projects. We are having now in a much more formal and organized way discussion with industrial, utility and infrastructure funds. We are having this discussion now aided by a major investment bank as well. So these conversations are going to start being engaged formally in Q1 next year, and we're sure that these are going to yield good results. And all of this leads us to the transition beyond just geographical go-to-market entities, as we have up to now, and move more towards anchor client go-to-market. And when we mean anchor clients, we're talking about large corporates or large infrastructure funds or large utilities, where they become your go-to-market and your sell channel. They can develop and build many of these projects in parallel, and we just start managing the relationship with them and the order book.
Lovely stuff. Well, it sounds like plenty for everybody to be looking forward to. But until we speak again, let me thank you both very much for joining us on Proactive this morning.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.